sir. In fact, we are on the 44th session today.
I know that. I know that. It's good.
Somehow or other, with the blessings of everybody, we were able to continue without any interruption.
That's good, Shyam. That's very good. You're doing a good job.
And the kind of interaction Pan India is really great. I mean, everybody is involved. Welcome to the 44th session of Legal Empowerment Through Interaction Lecture Series. No paraphernalia, no embellishments, nothing. Straight away to the speaker. Today we have one of the wonderful speakers around, Justice Sunil Thomas, sir. He'll be dealing with specific performance of contracts with 2018 amendment in mind. And I would like to thank Justice Ramkumar, sir, Justice Abraham Matthew, sir, Justice Chidambare, sir, for being present today. And let us get on with that. Sir, straight on to you, sir.
So thank you, Shyam. Respected Justice Ramkumar, Justice Chidambaresh, Justice Abraham Matthew, my dear brothers and sisters. I'm so happy to be with you today to have an interaction on a topic which I know most of you come across almost every other day, specifically fact. Either defending a case or pursuing a litigation under the Specific Relief Act. So what I propose to do is that I'll just refer to the specific performance of contracts and with reference to the 2018 amendment, how far it has improved, what are the improvements made by the 2018 amendment. Before that, I should thank Mr. Shyam Patman for giving me this opportunity to interact with you. He has been doing a wonderful job. I'm told that this is the 44th interactive session. Keep going, Mr. Shyam Patman. Thank you once again.
Thank you, sir.
As you know, so since I know that some among you must be junior lawyers, I'm also going into the elementary principles of Specific Relief Act. Not the Specific Relief Act, the specific performance of the contract. And I will go accordingly. So as you know, specific relief is a relief in specie. It's a specific, fixed, determinative relief granted by the courts. Now, if there is a breach of a contract, there can be two possible remedies. One is the specific relief, thereby making the defaulter perform his part of the contract. The second relief available to the aggrieved person will be to seek damages or other ancillary reliefs, including a refund of the amount paid in advance, etc. Whatever may be, there are two remedies. One is specific performance, the other one being the damages. Now, the law has evolved in England. The equity courts and the common law principle that evolved in England basically held the view that when there is a breach of a contract, damages should be the proper remedy and specific relief or specific enforcement of the terms of the contract shall only be a discretionary, selective, optional remedy subject to the discretion to be exercised by the court. This was the concept which evolved in England, carried by the common law courts. It had two criticisms. One, or the criticism against that concept was that, one, it never recognized or it seldom recognized the solemnity of a contract. Secondly, the moral obligations that arise from the contract is also not accepted or not given due recognition. However, that was a law that evolved. And for the first time, when the Specific Relief Act was introduced in India in 1877, we adopted that policy and conferred on courts the complete discretion to decide whether a specific relief is to be granted or not. Damages was generally recognized as the relief to be granted, and in exceptional cases, the optional relief or discretional relief of specific relief to be granted. This continued, and in 1963, Specific Relief Act of 1877 was repealed, and the new statute was introduced. That is Specific Relief Act of 1963. That statute also carried with it the same principle of treating breach of contract as the main remedy to be granted by the courts as damages, and the other one was an optional discretionary remedy subject to the satisfaction of the court. This was the law that continued. So what I will propose to do, then what happened was that in India, when economic liberalization came in, set in, a lot of foreign depository investment came to India. There were public-private participation projects. A lot of infrastructure projects also developed. So one thinking arose among the public, and not among the public, but among the people, that there are certain statutes which do not keep pace with the economic liberalization and the development that takes place in country. One of the statutes which was so identified was the Specific Relief Act, especially in relation to specific performance of contract. So what the central government did was that in 2016, an expert committee was constituted with the task of identifying the drawbacks of the Specific Relief Act and to suggest the improvements to be introduced. The expert committee found that the Specific Relief Act, especially the specific performance of the contract, could not keep pace with the developments that are taking place. They stood in the way of contracts being entered into or contracts being enforced, and it felt that even if a contract was entered into, there was no guarantee that it will be implemented. Even if it resulted in a litigation, there was no guarantee that the courts may grant a decree of specific performance. So ultimately, the committee felt that this act could not keep pace with the economic development. That also stood in the way of infrastructure developments. So the committee suggested that there should be the discretion vested with the court should be completely removed. And specific enforcement of the contract should be the right, statutory right. The second option, second suggestion, main suggestion, I'm just referring to two important suggestions made by the committee. The second suggestion was that there should be an alternative method of enforcement of contract in case of its breach. They suggested for one mechanism known as substituted performance of the contract. So that when there is a breach of a contract by one party, the aggrieved person will be entitled to call upon the opposite party to perform his part and to satisfy the terms of the contract, and in case of breach, I will perform it. A statutory notice was also suggested, and if that is not complied with, the notice, in spite of notice, he continues to violate the terms of the contract, then the aggrieved person should be given an option to perform the contract utilizing the services of an independent agency or his own employees. This was the concept of substituted performance suggested by the committee. there were a lot of other suggestions also. Accordingly, in 2018, the statute was amended. Substantive amendments were brought in. And that is the Amendment Act of 2018, which was notified and came into force on 1/10/2018. Before going into the details of those amendments, I'll just tell you that the salient features or the most important feature of the Amendment Act is that the discretion vested with the courts was completely taken away, removed. The restrictions, most of the restrictions imposed in exercising the power to order specific performance were removed. So virtually, it seems to have become a statutory right. We'll analyze how far it has become a statutory right or whether it still continues to be a discretionary right. For the time being, you understand that that's one of the important impact of the statute. The second one was that it recommended for one the method of substituted performance. In case there is a breach of the contract, the aggrieved person will be entitled to call upon the other side to perform the contract after giving him 30 days notice. And in case of non-performance, he has the option to get it done through his agents or through other his own employees. This is the wide scheme of the statute. Or a wide scheme or the impact of the basic impact of the Amendment Act. As you all know, Chapter 2, Part 2 of the Specific Relief Act deals with specific performance of the contract. The specific provisions are Sections 9 to Section 25, which deals with specific performance of contracts. According to me, or what I propose to do now in this session, is to take you through four important sections. I'm not saying that other sections are important, but these are the most crucial sections or the statutory provisions. And I will refer to the position that existed till 2018. Then I will refer to the amendments. So I will refer to four sections, Section 10, Section 14, Section 16, and Section 20. There are other provisions, as I told you earlier, which are also relevant, essential, but for the time being, I am confining myself mainly to these four sections. Section 10 generally deals with contracts which can be enforced. Section 14 deals with contracts which cannot be enforced. Section 16 deals with contracts which are the personal bar under the statute in enforcing a contract. And Section 20 deals with the discretion conferred on the court. If you refer to these four sections and the corresponding amendments, you will clearly understand the impact of the amendment. That's why I'm confining mainly to that. As I told you, Section 10 deals with the concept of what type of contracts can be enforced. Section 10 says that subject to other provisions of the statute, the court may, in its discretion, enforce a contract if two conditions are satisfied. The conditions are that if the damage consequent to the non-performance of the contract cannot be ascertained, or there is no standard for ascertaining the damage caused consequent to the non-performance of the contract, specific performance can be ordered. Or if the damage caused due to the non-performance of the contract is such that it can adequately be compensated in terms of money. So on satisfaction of these two conditions, the contract, a specific performance can be ordered. And there are two presumptions also under the statute. It says that in the case of immovable property, there, unless and until contrary is proved, the court shall presume that damage caused due to the non-performance of a contract involving an immovable property cannot be adequately compensated in terms of money. So the presumption is that if there is a breach of a contract relating to immovable property, it cannot be adequately compensated. Whereas in the case of a contract relating to movable property, the presumption is that it can be adequately compensated unless that subject matter involved is a matter of, not a matter of ordinary commerce or trade, or it's a matter on which the parties have got a personal interest, or the item is not easily available in the market. Now I'll come back to the scope of that section. If you read that section carefully, what you will find is that this is the statutory provision existed till 2018. If you go through the statute, what you will find is that one, it opens with the words, subject to the other provisions of the statute, the court may, in its discretion, grant specific performance when, if two conditions are satisfied, when there is no standard for ascertaining the damage caused consequent to the non-performance. Secondly, if the damage cost can be adequately compensated in terms of money. So what does it mean? If there is no standard, then specific performance. If damages will not satisfy the damage, then specific performance. Thereby, it clearly shows that it was a complete discretion vested with the court, and a specific performance would normally be granted only if there is no ascertainable method of quantifying the damage and the damage cannot be compensated in terms of money. The two presumptions I said in relation to immovable property and movable property are rebuttable presumptions. It can be rebutted by the other side, by the defendant, by saying that it can have otherwise. Even if these two are proved, still the court has the discretion. Court may in its discretion. Now, why discretion has been conferred on the courts to grant or not to grant specific relief of a contract in case of a breach of it? So this is section 10 of 1963 Act. Now what happened in the 2018 amendment was that both the yardsticks provided in the statute was removed. The discretion that the court may in its discretion grant the specific performance was also removed. May and discretion have gone. The presumptions have also been deleted. Now, in the 2018 amendment, what remains is that the court shall specifically enforce a contract subject to Section 11(2), Section 14, and Section 16. Or in other words, it gives an obligation on the court to grant decree for specific performance if it does not offend Section 11(2), which relates to the transfer of related to an agreement executed in relation to trust property, Section 14, contracts which cannot be enforced, and Section 16, the personal bar in enforcement of a contract. So virtually, the various types of contract discretion conferred on the court have been taken away by the 2018 amendment. And that's why some people say that it has virtually become a statutory right. When you compare with, when not only with the Section 10, when you compare with the amendments brought in Section 14, Section 16 and Section 20. So that is the scope of Section 14. Section 14. With this, I think now we can go to the next section of Section 16. What does Section 16 deal with? It, as I told you earlier, it says that there are certain contracts which cannot be specifically enforced, as provided under the 1963 Act, that is prior to the amendment brought in the year 2018. There are four types of contracts which cannot be enforced. The first contract is that when the compensation will be an adequate remedy for satisfying, will be an adequate remedy for the damages caused. So, virtually Section 16A provides that if, I'm sorry, sorry, not Section 16, 14, Section 14. Section 14 provides that if the contract can be specifically, or the damages caused can be compensated in terms of money, specific relief need not be, the contract need not be enforced. The second category was those category of contracts which run into so many minute and numerous details, or that contract is dependent on the personal qualification or volition of a person, of the parties. Say, for example, a contract which runs into minute details and numerous details. Such contracts cannot be enforced. Say, for example, a contract to prepare a sketch of a building, construct a plan and sketch of a multi-storied building. A lot of details may be involved in that, so that even if a decree is granted, the court may not be able to properly supervise and get it implemented. Or a contract which depends on the personal qualification or volition of the parties involved. One typical example can be a contract in relation to paint a picture by an expert artist. So that depends on the personal skill and qualification of that person. So probably it will fall within the category B of Section 14. Then the third category is contracts which by very nature of it is determinable, which has got a specific time limit, which can be determined by the parties either at their option or it is for a limited specified period. To lease out a building for a specific period, to do some agricultural operation during the cultivation period, to do some work during the summer period. These are contracts which are otherwise determinable, and courts may not grant a decree of specific enforcement of such contracts. And the last category is a contract which involves the performance of a continuous duty which the court cannot supervise. An act which involves a continuous duty to be performed by several persons or to be performed And it cannot be, and its enforcement cannot be completely satisfied by the court. One example can be a case wherein one person undertakes to construct a multi-storied building. That's one example. In relation to that, I will refer to one decision of the Supreme Court regarding continuous service. Just for the benefit of those who are interested, that decision is 2001 5 SCC 1010. Those who are interested can take down 2001 5 SCC page 1010. The name of the case is Her Highness Maharani Shanti Devi Gaikwad. Her Highness Maharani Devi Gaikwad versus S.H. Patel. Her Highness Maharani Shanti Devi Gaikwad versus S.H. Patel, 2001, 5 SCC, 1010. In that case, there was a contract in relation to the construction of several houses for the poor people. There was a breach of the contract and the matter was taken to the courts. When ultimately it reached the Supreme Court said that it involves the performance of that contract involves a continuous work to be done, continuous duty to be done, which the court cannot supervise and refuse to enforce the contract. The rationale behind is such a clause is that the work of the court cannot be spared to ensure that a continuous duty is performed by the aggrieved person, by the defaulter, and such contracts cannot be specifically enforced. These are the four categories of contracts which statutorily are held to be considered as contracts which cannot be specifically enforced under Section 14 of the Specific Relief Act. A contract for which a compensation will be the adequate relief. That is exact. That condition is specifically the same thing as that of 10. 10 subclause B. Whether damage can be compensated in terms of money. Second one is a case wherein it involves a minute and numerous details, or the contract involves the personal skill or volition of a person, or the personal qualification of persons involved. The third one is a contract which is otherwise determinable. Fourth one is a case wherein the contract involves performance of a continuous duty, which the court cannot supervise and implement. This is the statutory provision that existed till the amendment. The Amendment Act was introduced in 2018. Now I'll tell you what is the amendment brought in by the statute. Substantially, the contract involves, substantially only one clause was changed. The first clause. That's a case where that clause which says that when compensation in terms of money is adequate relief is now substituted by saying that if one person has obtained a substituted performance, as I mentioned earlier, if a substituted performance is done, then that contract need not be specifically enforced. That's the difference with all other B, C, and D remain the same. Now, in the meanwhile, one query has been raised as to whether could not the court have appointed an expert in the Gaikwad's case, Maharani Gaikwad's case, whether court could not have got it enforced by appointing an expert. But the difficulty involved is that, as I told you earlier, the statute has got two parts. One, there should be a continued performance of a continuous duty, which the court cannot supervise. And even by appointing a person, by appointing an expert, the court may not be able to, will not be able to supervise construction, whether it is in accordance with the plan, whether it is in accordance with the funds, then whether what are the paraphernalia to be taken, and whether it is completely in accordance with the specifications provided in the plan. So by appointment of an expert, this could not have been got over. That seems to be the view of the Supreme Court. So when we come to Section 14, what we find is that 14A has been modified and provided that pay, whether adequate compensation can be paid or not is not the criteria. And hence it has been amended and introduced with other concept of substituted service performance. If a person has obtained a substituted performance, that contract need not be performed, enforced. I'll come to substituted performance in detail when we come to Section 20. Section 20 now deals with the substituted performance. I think this much is clear to you. If that be so, shall we go to the next stop of Section 16? And I think whenever doubts come, I'll try to clarify. Ah, yes, correct. That is page number is 1010. Yes, now we go to Section 16, which deals with the personal bar against enforcement of a contract, which you must have, all of you must have dealt with at one point or another. The concept which involves the readiness and willingness. Section 16 has got three ingredients. The personal bar applies in three different situations. One, a contract cannot be specifically enforced in favor of a person who will not otherwise be entitled to get compensation. That is Section 16A. That is, if the person who approaches the court with a grievance that there is a breach of contract and seeks relief is even legally not entitled to get compensation even, then he cannot get a contract enforced. One example which I can tell you is a case wherein a person enters into a contract for the sale of an immovable property over which he has no title. Then he comes for a specific performance of the contract. Since he has no title, there is no question of property being assigned or contract being specifically enforced, and he is not entitled to get such a relief. So if he is not entitled to get compensation, he will not be entitled to get the contract specifically enforced also. The second is a case wherein the person seeking relief has become incapable of performance or has violated the essential condition of the contract or that he has committed a fraud. So if a person has become incapable, contract cannot be enforced in his favor. If he has violated the fundamental duties involved, contract cannot be enforced in his favor. Thirdly, if he has committed fraud, court cannot enforce it. Need not enforce. This is the personal bar against performance of a contract. Now we come to clause 16C. Section 16 says that contract cannot be enforced in favor of a person who fails to aver and prove that he has the capacity, he has performed his part of the contract and he has been ready and willing to perform his part of the contract. This is the clause which we invariably invoke by saying that the other person was not ready and willing to perform his part of the contract. That means a person who fails to ever plead and prove that he has performed his part of the contract is not entitled to get a specific performance. So there are three conditions provided under Section 16. One is that if a person has become is not entitled to recover the compensation, he is not entitled to get a specific performance. If a person has become incapacitated, a decree of a specific performance cannot be granted in his favor. Or if he has committed fraud, or if he has committed fault of the essential basic condition of the contract. Lastly, if he fails to plead and prove, ever and prove that he has performed his part of the contract. Then regarding Section 16C, there are two explanations. One explanation is which you all know. That is, when there is a clause in the contract obliging the person who has approached the court to make payment of money, he is not bound to deposit the money in the court to show his bona fides unless and until he is called upon to deposit it by the court. Or in other words, deposit of the money liable to be paid by the person claiming it is not a condition precedent or a condition or a prerequisite for moving the court. He need only deposit as and when directed by the court. The second condition is that he should aver that or plead that he has been ready and willing to perform his part of the contract. These are the two explanations. Now, it also gives the court wide discretion. If the compensation can be entitled in performance as per, these are the sections which were in existence or provisions existing till 2018 prior to amendment. Now, the 2018 amendment brought in one main change. Clause 16A was deleted and it was substituted by a clause which says that if the person has obtained the personal substitute of performance, contract need not be enforced. Secondly, regarding the averment of performance, readiness and willingness, as contemplated under Section 16C, has been deleted. Now it is, he need not plead as such or aver as such. He need only prove that he has performed his part of the contract or he was ready and willing to perform his part of the contract. Essentially, the liability to make a specific pleading that he was ready and willing to perform the contract has now been given a go-by But he should prove. Now the question may arise, whether without a pleading can it be proved? We will go to the cases, case laws, and consider how far the concept of pleading and proving readiness and willingness have been dealt with by the Supreme Court. Regarding the readiness and willingness and the pleading and proving of that, I'll give you four citations, which I feel are the more important decisions. One is, I'm not going into the facts of the case and the principle, all are same. One is N.P. Thirujnanam. Thirujnanam. N.P. Thirujnanam. N.P. Thirujnanam died, represented by his LRs, versus Dr. R. Jagan Mohan Rao, 1995, 5 SCC 115. N.P. Thirujnanam died, represented by the LRs, versus Dr. R. Jagan Mohan Rao, 1995, 5 SCC 115. The second decision is a rather new decision, that is C.S. Venkatesh. C.S. Venkatesh versus A.S.C. Murthy. A.S.C. Murthy. A Supreme Court judgment pronounced sometime in February. I could not get the exact citation of that, but I will give you the case number. It is available on the website. CA Civil Appeal, that is CA 8425 of 2019. 8425 of 2019. C.S. Venkatesh versus A.S.C. Murthy. CA Civil Appeal 8425 of 2019. The third decision is Kalavadi versus Ragesh Kumar. Kalavadi, K-A-L-A-V-A-T-I. Kalavadi versus Ragesh Kumar. AR 2018 SC 960. The fourth decision is Vijayabharathi versus Savitri. Vijayabharathi versus Savitri. 2018-11 SCC 761. Vijayabharathi versus Savitri, 2018-11 volume SCC 761. All the four decisions relate to the concept of pleading and proving the readiness and willingness. And in all the cases, it has been consistently held that the readiness and willingness, as all you all know, that readiness and willingness should commence from the date of execution of the contract till the end. And unless the plaintiff is able to prove, or the person claiming readiness and willingness is able to prove, that he was ever ready and willing to perform his part of the contract, is not likely to succeed. Now, Vijayabharathi's case, the last one which I referred to, Vijayabharathi versus Savitri, that has gone, one additional point was also considered in that. That was a case wherein the defendant assigned his property, the seller assigned his property to a third party who was implicated in the proceeding. The question came up whether the assignee can also set up the plea that plaintiff was not ready and willing to perform his part of the contract. Supreme Court said that the assignee is also entitled to raise a contention regarding readiness and willingness, which the assigner is also entitled to. That's only the scope of that. Now, as I told you earlier, statute says that there must be an averment. It should have averment, pleading and proof regarding the readiness and willingness. Is it absent? Suppose that is not specifically pleaded, or in other words, the readiness and willingness is not explicitly mentioned. The words are not carried forward in the pleading, but ingredients are there. Will it be sufficient? There are two Supreme Court decisions which says that, which has been held in other decisions also. Readiness and willingness is something which should come out from the pleading, and a mechanical reproduction of the terms, statutory words, is not required. If the parties have pleaded the ingredients of readiness and willingness, and they have also, parties went for trial knowing that this was a defense, at a later stage, other side cannot raise a contention that there was no specific pleading. There are two decisions on this. Sayed Dastagir, S-Y-E-D, Sayed Dastagir, D-A-S-T-A-G-I-R, Dastagir, versus T.R. Gopalakrishna, 1999, 6 SCC, 337. Sayed Dastagir versus T.R. Gopalakrishna, 1999, 6 SCC, 337. That view was followed by the Supreme Court again reiterated in Vishwanath Ghosh versus Govinda Ghosh, 2014, 1 SCC, 605. 2014, 1 SEC, 605. There is one latest decision of the Supreme Court again on the question whether the conduct of the party will disentitle him from claiming the relief. The conduct of a person will, how far he can be deprived of or he can be denied the right of specific performance. That is in Atmaram versus Charanjit Singh. Atmaram versus Charanjit Singh. SLP Civil. 27598, SLP Civil 27598 of 2016. That's also a 2020 decision. I could not get at the latest citation of that. That's also available on the website. So what happened in that case was that regarding the breach of the contract in 1996, notice was sent. Then suit was filed only in 1999, 3 years thereafter, just on the verge of the limitation period. And that was filed as a suit for injunction. Then it was sought to be permitted to be amended by paying court fee for specific performance. When the matter came up to the Supreme Court took the view that this indicated that the plaintiff was not very, very diligent. And consequently, he is not entitled for the decree. So these are the aspects regarding pleadings, etc., readiness and willingness, and the powers conferred on the court under Section 16. In the 2018 amendment, only one substantial change has been brought. That is, the first clause has been changed, which says that if a person has obtained substituted performance, there is a personal bar against execution. Then, as I told you earlier, the obligation to plead has been removed and the obligation is now only to prove. Probably, one of the reasons for removing it may be that some courts used to indiscriminately or without any discretion, indiscreetly used to dismiss the suits on the technical ground that you have not specifically used the words pleading and proving. Probably that must be the reason. But anyway, proof of readiness and willingness and that he has performed the part of the contract is absolutely essential even now. So this is the scope of Section 16. Now, as I told you, we will go to the fourth important section which I referred to. We have covered Section 10, Section 14, Section 16, and now we are referring to Section 20. The original Section 20 as it stood referred to, dealt with the discretion conferred on the courts. Section 20 specifically said that granting of decree of specific performance was the discretion of the court, was within the discretion of the court. However, it was made clear that merely because it is lawful to grant a decree, the court need not, or court is not under an obligation to grant a decree of specific performance merely because it is lawful to do so. Then Section 20 again said that, however, the arbitration of the discretion to be exercised by the court shall not be a arbitrary discretion, but it shall be based on sound and legal principles and capable of being corrected by a court of appeal. So that what section, the purpose of Section 20 was to confer discretion on the court, but putting the limits on the discretion within which the limits within which the court can exercise the discretion. It said that it is within the discretion of the court, but it is not mandatory on the part of the court to grant decree merely because it is lawful to do so. Then it cautions by saying that the discretion shall not be arbitrary, but it must be based on sound legal principles which can be corrected in appeal by a court of appeal. So that it must be susceptible to an interference by a court of appeal as to whether the discretion exercised by the court is proper or not. Virtually it indicates that for exercising the discretion, court has to give reasons for that, valid reasons, so that the appellate court can sit it over. Now, this was a position that existed till 2018. The consequence of 2018 was that this section has been completely removed, completely abandoned, or that discretion conferred on the court under Section 20 has been now substituted with a new provision, which, as I told you earlier, is the provision relating to substituted performance. Substituted performance means, as I indicated earlier, if there is a breach of a contract, the aggrieved person, the person affected by the breach, is empowered, is authorized under Section 20 to issue a notice to the opposite side, calling upon him to perform his part of the contract. And what statute prescribes is the notice shall be not less than 30 days. And if after serving such a notice, if the other side does not perform his part of the contract or comply with the terms of the contract, the plaintiff will be the person who sends such a notice, the affected person will be entitled to get that contract performed by engaging independent agency or by engaging his own employees. So this is a new innovative mechanism contemplated under the statute by which aggrieved person gets a new relief. Without going to the court of law, he is entitled to get the contract enforced, subject to the condition by which is known as the principle of substituted performance. The performance to be done by the party to the contract is performed by the aggrieved person through the other person, to engaging his own persons. And there is one more right conferred on him. If he is ready and willing to perform, if there is a breach of the contract and a substituted performance is complied with, the person who gets this done is entitled to get the cost, expenses and compensation if any damage is also caused. So that the aggrieved person is fully satisfied. Without delay, without resorting to the court of law, he can get it done and recover from him the cost, the expenses and compensation. For that purpose only, he need go to the court of law. One question was put by one of the participants as to whether is that right available to both sides. Of course, that's available to both sides. So this is the peculiarity of the concept of substituted service performance under Section 20. Now, when you analyze Section 20, what you will find is that the wide discretion given to the courts under Section 20 prior to the 2018 amendment has been completely omitted, and a new provision known as substituted performance, which I said earlier, it is an innovative mechanism, has been introduced. So virtually in matters which may come up later, the provision for substituted performance may assume significance. So the impact of this amendment will be that whenever new contracts are being entered into, any contract are being entered into, parties will take care of imposing conditions for the performance of the contract and substituted performance. In case there is a default, what will be the method of carrying out substituted performance? What will be the terms and conditions? Definitely, such a performance is done at the risk and cost of the other person. And the method of the safety valve provided under Section 20 is that, or it being misused by one unscrupulous party, utilizing the terms of the specific performance is that, or substituted performance is the necessity for giving a notice 30 days, minimum 30 days notice, so that the possibility of this statutory provision, statutory protection given to the aggrieved person being misused to make an unlawful bargain can be avoided. That will give an option to the other side to say that I have done my part, you have not done your part, you perform your part, whatever may be. So that this is the scope of substituted performance. We will consider what is the impact of these amendments on the other, the earlier legal position. But regarding the equity principles, I will take you to 2-3 decisions which may apply to cases which have arisen under the earlier statute. We will come to the question whether statute is retrospective or not. Now I will take you to three decisions. Regarding the equity principles, A. Kanti Mani versus Nasru Ahmad, N-A-S-R-U, Ahmad, 2017, 4 SEC, 654. The well-settled principle that a person who seeks equity should do equity was considered in that. A. Kanti Mani versus Nasru Ahmad, 2017, 4 SEC, 654. The other decision is Jaya Kantan versus Abhay Kumar, 2017, 5 SEC, 176. 2017, 5 SEC, 176. The third one is Yusuf Ghan, Y-O-U-S-E-F, Yusuf Ghan versus Prajida Builders, P-R-A-J-I-D-A, Prajida Builders. Not builders, I'm sorry, developers. Prajida Developers. 2018, 12 SEC, 683. All decisions deal with the concept of equity. As under the 1963 Act. Now, if we cumulatively consider the amendments in Section 10, Section 14, Section 16, and Section 20, you will find that the wide discretion conferred on the courts have been completely taken away. The options given to the court to consider whether an alternate relief of damages should be granted or not has been taken away. This is the position. I'll come to. There are a few other important amendments. I'll just refer to that. Before that, I'll go into one aspect. Under the original Act, when litigation started coming on several issues, the courts have also evolved how to apply the principle of equity in a more reasonable manner by applying newer yardsticks. Say, for example, one of the difficulties that courts used to face was that when a litigation ultimately comes to the Supreme Court, it takes a lot of time. In the meanwhile, normally the value of the property might have gone up. If a specific performance is ordered at the rate which was agreed between the parties long back, will it not be equitable? That was one of the worries of the Supreme Court. Definitely, difference in price cannot be a basic criteria also. But that pricked the conscience of the courts. One typical example which I told you, that was a case wherein, I'll give the citation, very important decision, Nirmala Anand. Nirmala Anand versus Advent Corporation. Advent, A-D-V-E-N-T Corporation. Nirmala Anand versus Advent Corporation. 2002, 8 SEC, 146. 2002, 8 SEC, 146. That was a case wherein the Supreme Court was faced with this contingency. The peculiar facts was like this. In the year 1966, plaintiff entered into an agreement to purchase a flat from the builder in Bombay. The price agreed in 1966 was 60,000 rupees. Alleging breach of the contract, she went to the court. At the time of conclusion of the trial, the trial court held that during the interregnum, the price of flats in Bombay have gone up. Prices have gone up. So I am not granting the discretion, because that will be an unfair bargain, and it will be unfair to the builder and an unfair bargain for the plaintiff. Matter was taken up in the appellate, before the appellate court. Appellate court also took the same view. The matter was taken to the Supreme Court. As the citation shows, the case was decided by the Supreme Court in the year 2002. That is long after 36 years. Supreme Court found that merely because the price, there is a huge escalation of price, cannot be a ground for denying the legitimate right of a plaintiff. There was nothing to show that plaintiff has committed any default. At the same time, Supreme Court said that we cannot be ignorant of the fact that prices have gone up, and if the plaintiff is directed to pay the 60,000 rupees only, even after 36 years, that will work out injustice. So by balancing the equities, the Supreme Court granted a conditional decree by which the plaintiff was directed to pay 6,25,000 rupees more than the agreed amount, and the builder was directed to assign the property. So that the court, what the Supreme Court said was that the benefit of escalation of price shall not exclusively go to the buyer. And fairness demands that they should bear it equally. So that was a new yard in applying the equity principle. This view was appreciated by the Supreme Court in later decisions also. There are two decisions of the Supreme Court in 2015 which accepted the same proposition and applied the law like accordingly. They are A. Prakash versus B. R. Sambat Kumar. B. R. Sambat Kumar versus B. R. Sambat Kumar, 2015, 1 SEC 597. Second is Zarina Siddiqui, Zarina, Z-A-R-I-N-A, Zarina Siddiqui versus A. Ramalingam, 2015, 1 SEC 705. In both the decisions,
both are by the same judge.
By the same judge.
Same judge.
both are by same judge as Iqbal. Sarina Siddiqui, and both laid down the same principle, accepting the law laid down in Nirmala Anand's case. Now I'll refer to one more case citation. Wherein the balancing of equities.
Citation.
I'll repeat the citations once again. K. Prakash versus B. R. Sampath Kumar. K. Prakash versus B. R. Sampath Kumar. 2015, 1 SEC 597. 2015. 1 SEC 597. The second one is Zarina Siddiqui versus A. Ramalingam. 2015. 1 SEC 705. These are the two decisions. Now, there is yet another decision in which the concept of balancing equities was also applied by the Supreme Court. That decision is Syscon, S-Y-S-C-O-N, Syscon, S-Y-S-C-O-N, Syscon Consultation Private Limited. Syscon Consultation Private Limited versus Primella, P-R-I-M-E-L-L-A. Primella Sanitary Products, 2016, 10 SEC 35. Syscon Consultation Private Limited versus Primella Sanitary Products Private Limited, 2016, 10 SEC, page 35. In that case, what happened was that there was a contract by which the co-owners agreed to assign the entire property to another person. Alleging breach of the contract, the buyer filed a suit. On evidence, it was found that one of the co-owner had not accepted the assignment deed, the agreement, contract. On the other hand, the other co-owners relied on a power of attorney executed, purported to have been executed by this co-owner. In fact, he had not executed the power of attorney. When the matter reached the Supreme Court took the view that applying the principle of equity, the other co-owners can be asked to assign the property, their share of the property, leaving apart the undivided share of the person who objected to that. Normally, these are come up in practical situations when you exercise the discretion to that extent. I was just trying to demonstrate how the exercise of discretion was being improved by the Supreme Court having regard to the change in situation. Now we will come to one more point. That is an ancillary subject which often comes in the case of specific performance of agreements, contracts. That is whether time shall be deemed as the essence of the contract. The main decision on that point is Chandrani's case of the Constitution Bench. Chandrani, C-H-A-N-D, Chandrani versus Kamal Rani. Chand Rani, CHAND, Chand Rani versus Kamal Rani. SEC 519. Chand Rani versus Kamal Rani, 1993, 1 SEC 519. In that, the Constitution bench of the Supreme Court held that there is no presumption in law that time shall be the essence of the contract. But whether the contract was intended to be performed within the specified time, and whether the essence of the time is to be considered as the essence of the contract, can be gathered from one, the nature of the transaction. Two, express and implied conditions in the contract. Thirdly, considering the subject matter involved. So what the Supreme Court said was that even though there is no presumption that time shall be presumed to be the essence of the contract, considering the entire facts, court can discern from the available materials as to whether the parties intended to treat the contract time as the essence of the contract, notwithstanding an explicit provision in the contract. So that was Chandrani's decision, which was being followed, and especially we used to say that in the case of immovable property, time was not to be treated as the essence of the contract. But the principle is that if other terms, express or implied terms, are there which indicate that, it will have to be time has to be performed. It has to be performed within a reasonable time. The question whether we should follow that principle again or not came up for the consideration of the Supreme Court in K.S. Vidyadhanam, K.S. Vidyanadam. A.S. Vidya Nadam and others versus Vairavan, V-A-I-R-A-V-A-N, Vairavan, 1997, 3 SEC 1. A.S. Vidya Nadam and others versus Vairavan, 1996, 3 SEC 1. What Supreme Court held was that it is true that there is no presumption that time was the essence of the contract as held by the Constitution bench. But at the same time, suit has to be filed within the statutory limitation period of 3 years. Merely because there is no specific provision that time shall be the essence of the contract, does it mean that the courts can overlook other provisions in the contract which indicate the significance of urgent performance and hold that all suits filed within the stipulated time shall be treated as valid? That what the court indicated was that even if there is no specific time stipulated in the contract that time will be the essence of the contract, and even if there is a limitation period prescribed, the suit shall be filed within a limitation period. Why the Supreme Court held was that, according to the Supreme Court, the concept of time is not the essence of the contract, which evolved in England, was at a time when prices of the goods remained steady, inflation was unknown, so that even if the type contract was not performed within the stipulated time, there will not be a substantial difference in the price, and it may not adversely affect either party. But the Supreme Court said, now it's a reality that prices have gone up, at least in relation to properties situated in urban areas. Inflation is there. Having regard to that, it requires a relook. The principle that time shall not be treated as the essence of the contract needs a relook. This view was expressed by the Supreme Court again by Justice Ravindran in another decision, Sharadamani Kandappan. Sharadamani, Sharadamani, Sharadamani Kandappan versus S. Rajalakshmi and others. 2011, 12 SEC. Page 18, Sharadamani Kandappan versus S. Rajalakshmi and others, 2011, 12 SEC, page 18. So that is the concept of whether time is the essence of the contract. Wherein Supreme Court started thinking in terms whether we should still follow the early principle. Now I'll quickly refer to few other statutory provisions which have been introduced by way of 2018 amendment. One important section that was apart from the sections which I have referred to, the amendments which I have referred to in section 10, 14, 16 and 20. Another provision which was introduced by way of amendment in 2018 was Section 14A. Section 14A provided that enabled the courts to appoint experts for assisting the court, aiding the court in matters which the court feels it is required. Say, for example, especially when you know that you have said that courts have, the amendment has given more prominence to the economic development, the infrastructural development, and the construction activities also. So the court felt that the statute felt, the parliament felt, that there should be a lot of developments in the field of commerce, industry, infrastructure, which may require some technical assistance. So to enable the courts to get at the real factual issue on matters relating to their field of experience, court is competent to appoint experts. Expert or experts. Section says that the report submitted by the expert will form part of the record, and the expert can be summoned by either side for examination. Just like the commission report, but it's an expert report. What about the expenses? Expense shall be met by both sides as directed by the court. So, appointment of an expert to enable the court to have scientific or technical data for analyzing the facts involved, court is given the power. That is Section 14A. Then there are three important sections newly introduced after Section 20. They are Section 20A, 20B and 20C. 20A provides that no court shall grant injunctions in relation to contract of contracts relating to construction involving infrastructure projects if the injunction is likely to impede, obstruct the infrastructure project. I've been repeatedly referring to the infrastructure projects. What are the infrastructure projects? A schedule has been introduced which gives you the list of projects which the government, which the statute felt are the infrastructure projects, like power project, thermal project, construction of dams, construction of roads, buildings, etc. So that there is a bar under Section 20A. Civil courts shall not grant injunction in relation to infrastructure or contracts involving infrastructure if it is likely to impede the construction, so that it will not affect a dispute raised by one side, may not affect the progress of the work because of the significance which the government, which the parliament feels is required to be given to infrastructure projects. Section 20B contemplates constitution of special courts for dealing with infrastructure disputes involving infrastructure projects. Under Section 20B, the state government is empowered to constitute or designate one or more courts as special courts to deal with matters involving infrastructure progress. As I told you earlier, that's the significance given to such projects and intended for an early disposal. Infrastructure courts are intended for trying matters of suits relating to infrastructure. The third section is Section 20B. I'm sorry, 20C. 20C fixes a time limit for disposal of suits under the Specific Relief Act. It provides that the suits shall be decided within a period of 12 months from the date of service of summons on the defendant. That is the time limit prescribed under Section 20C. It also says that, but the time can be extended for a total period of 6 months for reasons to be recorded by the court. So the intention is to ensure that matters involving infrastructure projects and other projects and specific performance suits or other suits under Specific Relief Acts are not held up and for a speedy, effective adjudication. So these are the important amendments coming under the statute, especially in relation to specific performance of contracts. I have fairly covered all the topics. And when we analyze the provisions, what is that we understand? The main thrust is the wide discretion given to the courts have been taken away. Second is that the concept of substituted performance, which is a new and innovative provision, has been introduced. These are the main important projects. Now the question arises, is the statute retrospective in operation? If you refer to Section 2, the Amending Act of 2018, what you will find is that there is no residuary clause in the Act which say, or a transitory provision, and there is no saving provision also which says that the statute will be retrospective in operation. Question is, the 2018 amendment, will it apply to pending proceedings? As you all know, procedural statutes are considered as retrospective in operation, but substantive law, unless otherwise specifically provided, will be deemed to be prospective. This is a basic principle. And of course, there are divergent decisions also on that. In the absence of a transitory provision, a saving clause, can we say that 2018 amendment will apply to all pending proceedings? Now, there is no direct decision on that. We are waiting for some judicial pronouncement on that directly on the point. But there are a few other decisions which have dealt with the incidental aspects. There are two High Court decisions which refer, which say that this specific relief act is procedural in nature to judicial redress. Since it contemplates judicial redress, it can only be treated as a procedure law according to these the views of two high courts. They are Maulavi Ali Hussain, Maulvi, M-O-U-L-V-I, Maulavi Ali Hussain, H-O-S-S-A-I-N, versus Rajkumar Haldar. Rajkumar Haldar, AR 1943, Calcutta 417. Maulavi Ali Hussain versus Rajkumar Haldar, AR 1943, Calcutta 417. The other one is a Bombay decision. Hanumandrao Deshmukh versus Krishna Bai. Krishna Bai, 1986, One Bombay CR, page 50. Hanumanth Rao Deshmukh versus Krishna Bai, 1986, Bombay CR 50. In both the cases, the respective high courts took the view that since specific relief act contemplates judicial process, judicial redressal of grievances, it can be treated as procedural in nature. It did not go into the question whether the act was retrospective or not. But the question whether the 1963 amendment or the 1877 specific relief act, when it was repealed by 1967 specific relief act, whether the question will remain, 1963 act, whether it will have a retrospective operation or not, was considered by a Calcutta High Court in Radhe Shyam Kamila, K-A-M-I-L-A, Kamila, Radhe Shyam Kamila versus Crayon Bala, AR 1971, Calcutta 341. Adopting the view that, I'll repeat, AR 1971, Calcutta 341. Adopting the principle which was held by the other high courts, it said that, it held, Calcutta High Court held that 1963 Act completely replaced the 1877 Act. And with the introduction of that Act, all the pending proceedings should be covered by 1963 Act. Or in other words, the view of the Calcutta High Court was that it will act prospectively, retrospectively, and it will apply in the case of all pending proceedings. Now, there is one Supreme Court decision which did not deal with all these questions, but while discussing about the Supreme Court, the specific relief act, it held the view that it is procedural in law, procedural in nature, being a process of judicial redressal. That decision is Aadhunik Steels Limited, Aadhunik. A-D-H-U-N-I-K, Aadhunik Steels Limited. Versus Orissa Manganese and Minerals. Orissa Manganese and Minerals Private Limited. 7 SCC, page 125. Aadhunik Steels Limited versus Orissa Manganese and Minerals Private Limited, 2007, 7 SCC, page 125. While discussing other issues, the Supreme Court incidentally held that Specific Relief Act is a process of judicial redressal of grievance of the parties, and thereby, and it grants reliefs in specie, and hence, it can be considered as a procedural one. Now, applying these decisions, we will have to consider whether the statute is retrospective or not. If you strictly go by the Supreme Court decision of 2007, we will have to say that the statute as such is a procedural one. But the question is whether it takes away any substantive rights of the parties. It affects the substantive rights of the parties. There are divergent views on that. One view expressed is that we will go by the earlier decision of the Calcutta High Court, which said that 1963 replaced completely the statute, and hence it has become retrospective. And the Supreme Court decision, hence the statute is retrospective in operation. But there is one thing that you have to keep in mind. The main important aspect of the amendment is that the discretion conferred on the courts have been taken away. Discretion was coupled with certain defenses which were available to the defender, to the opposite side. They have also been deleted. Can you still say that it has not affected the rights of the parties? This is the issue to be considered. Till that is decided, we will have to wait for a decision. I think three honorable judges are here. Justice Chidambaram, Justice Abraham Mathew, and Justice Ram Kumar. If Justice Ram Kumar has also joined. I would like to have their views on that. So these are the important topics. Now, shall we go for a discussion, Mr. Another Patnaiken?
Definitely, sir. Sir, before that, the last statement you made, sir, discretion available to the court was in fact a substitution of party autonomy. Substantive or procedural, whichever way, sir, you would like to take it. But end of the day, I would like to have an agreement with X, Y, or Z in whichever manner I would like to have. And he also with open eyes have entered into that.
Yes.
Should we let a third party, whether it be the court or any other authority, to intervene and say that I am right, I am not just equity, etc. comes in?
Yes.
Does not the legislature by 2018 amendment reiterate and party autonomy wherein they at least leave it
the
to
sanctity of the contract?
More than that, sir, it leaves to the parties that they are sensible enough to enter into contracts, like, I mean, whichever manner they would like to, instead of somebody sitting in judgment of that.
Yes. That is true. That is one point of looking at it.
So, if that be the case, sir, the question of retrospective application, if not made applicable, will it not work out manifest injustice?
But at the same time, can we not say, when the breach was committed and when the suit was filed, the defendants who are entitled to certain defenses,
Not under the contract,
but a statutory right to say that damages can be compensated in terms of money. Now that is gone. True, that's one way of looking at it.
Correct, sir.
Yes. Just Abraham Matthew, his lordship.
Sir, would you like to add something?
I will. Waiting for our
computer,
just Chidambaram. Sir, better unmute. And in the meanwhile, we'll request Advocate Mankumaran, sir, to just have his inputs.
What is it?
My Lord, it's an illuminating talk.
Thank you.
No doubts, rather my thoughts I am sharing.
Yes, please.
Lordship, that Section 41 of the Indian Contract Act is not relevant because Section 20 starts with saying that it is without prejudice to the generality of the provisions of the Contract Act.
Correct.
Also, if there is a contractual clause between the parties, starts with saying that contract without prejudice to the generality of the Indian contract and also subject to the contract between the parties.
Yes.
In that case, Section 41 imposes a bar, in fact, because when a promisee accepts performance of promise from a third person, he cannot afterwards enforce it against the promisor. So that based on rule of privity. Then, if that be the case, without making adequate provision in the contract, can substituted performance be sought for? That's one question.
That's a problem that will arise.
Exactly.
That's a problem which will arise because substituted performance was not contemplated.
Correct.
Yes.
It was not in the statute at that point of time.
Exactly. So
that's the real issue that will arise.
Exactly. So that there is incongruity between Section 41 and Section 20.
20, yes.
That's one aspect. Then second aspect is, my lord, that is Section 20 permits substituted performance from a third party. If a party is suffering breach, obtaining substituted performance with variation or novation of the contracts, is the defaulter exonerated from paying damages.
No, no. How can there be innovation of contract? Because the original contract subsists.
I will explain.
And by the statutory provision, he is given a right to, so that there is no innovation as such, and the original contract stands.
I will explain.
Please.
I will explain it. Suppose it is a construction contract. In a construction contract.
Yes.
Suppose if there is default, the contractor is defaulting, and the party who is suffering breach is getting substituted performance through another contractor.
Yes, yes.
He can only get substituted performance in terms of the existing contract only. The
original contract, yes, existing contract.
Otherwise, the difficulty is that the defaulter would be bound to pay damages at the rates in the contract.
Correct,
modified.
Correct.
So, is it possible? Because...
Why not? I'll tell you the reason. The person gets substituted performance. Then comes the question of cost, expenses, and the compensation. In this claim, is he not entitled to raise the contention that I am not bound to pay that? And is he not entitled to seek the relief? Because that's a question now that will arise.
Yes.
Under the guise of substituted performance, something more is done.
Something more is done.
Something more is done. Or assume that using the same materials, the same instead of that, a very expensive contract is engaged, and bring it under the heading of expenses and costs. Maybe more technologically savvy, technologically competent person is engaged. Say, for example, new machineries are used for the construction purpose, which was not contemplated under the statute.
Yes.
Or in other words, a person who enters into a contract to get the work done will try to get that work done at the most least expensive method. When a substituted performance is used, he can, to spite that man, and see that all the new innovative methods are used, expensive methods are used, but without violating the terms. Is it not?
Yes.
That's a problem that will arise.
The problem will arise.
That for the time being, as far as pending suits are concerned, that provision will not apply because then that has not been invoked if it is made retrospective.
But in contracts yet to come.
Yet to come. That's why I indicated that in such cases, since the new provision has come in, parties will be very careful in incorporating terms regarding substituted performance.
They have to be.
Because it is at the risk. You will have to pay through the nose.
Yes.
Suppose he lands, the person who is bound to perform lands in the financial difficulty and is unable to do work, which cannot be a legal defense. Still, that work gets done through the other person and all this money is lost.
Yes.
These are the practical difficulties that will arise.
Then, one more doubt.
Pardon?
In a contract for sale of immoral property, normally the statutory lien under section 55 subsection 6b is available to a purchaser. The seller is invoking the clause of substituted performance, and he is selling it to a third party. That is also substituted performance.
Yes.
Then if that be the case, will the section 20 be having an effect of keeping at bay the statutory lien provision?
Statutory lien will also be the...
Statutory
lien. But the problem will be, to whom it is being invoked, the person to whom he has got it assigned.
Yes, exactly.
That's the problem.
That's the problem.
So that virtually it will affect the interest of a third party. which were not contemplated by the statute. Not contemplated by both sides. So that that cannot be enforced to that extent.
So that there are some difficulties in practical side.
Yes.
Performance. That is what.
Now I'll tell you one more thing regarding the retrospective operation. There is a recent decision of our High Court wherein this issue was indicated, but the court did not consider that. That decision is Joshi versus Subhash Thomas. Joshi versus Subhash Thomas, 2020, 2 ILR 458. In that, the appeal was considered, it related to a decree passed long back.
What's the page number?
2020, 2 ILR 458. Joshi versus Subhash. Subhash Thomas. A decree under the old statute was under challenge. Matter came up in 2020 after the amendment has come into operation. One of the contentions set up was that amendment has come in. Court did not answer that as such, but said that the discretion under Section 20 should have been exercised, thereby implying that that was not applied. Though the court did not answer that issue. Incidentally, that we lost one opportunity of having a question of retrospective operation being decided by the court.
Sir, uncomfortable it might be to confront a question, but still, a particular date, can it decide how a matter has to be decided or not?
Yes.
Because if a litis has been kept alive, a litigation is still alive, or somebody, I mean, once the matter is over, there is absolutely no issue. But if litigation is still in whatever stage it might be, maybe a suit or an appeal, am I not entitled to get the benefit of this statutory interdict?
At what point of time? All the rights available accrues to the party at the time of institution of suit.
From the date of institution.
From the date of suit. That's a problem that will come up. Because a lot of matters must be pending before the Supreme Court, High Court.
Correct.
Covered by the 1963 Act. 2018 Act came only 2 years back. So that issue needs to be answered.
Another anomaly may also arise.
Yeah.
Because the would have to adopt different yardsticks in the same set of facts.
Yeah.
In one case, discretion will be exercised.
Yeah.
In the next case, he cannot.
That's a problem. That's a problem that will come up.
That is where I started by saying that does it not work out to manifest injustice just because of the time lag?
Because you are looking at from the angle of the plaintiff only.
No, absolutely not, sir. What am I saying that manifest injustice in the sense like when the law is being respected, sir, because not because it's perfect, but it's equally applicable to everybody.
Applicable to parties, correct.
So if that equation does not work out, then don't we have a problem?
Honestly, if I am asked, I will say that it cannot have a prospective operation because of these practical difficulties. That's one view, but subject to what the others also say. Because we have to look at it in a broader angle. Let us see what Justice Chidambaram has to say. His Lordship?
Chidambaram, sir, 1 second, sir. I think, yes. 1 second.
Chidambaram,
sir, I think for the time being, he's not available.
Nakumar sir has not joined.
Okay, I will just participate now.
Yes, please.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Mr. Mohan Kumar said that there is incongruity between Section 41 Contract Act.
Correct.
And Section 20 of the Specific Relief Act. In fact, there is no incongruity. Section 41 actually, what does it mean? He should not have double benefits.
Correct.
You cannot get performance from the opposite party and from a third party. That is actually Section 41 of the Contract Act.
Yes.
But Section 20, Section 16 of the amended Specific Relief Act says that that's a personal disqualification for getting a decree for specific performance.
Yes.
But he has already got a substitute service.
Yes.
So I think there is no incongruity between this 41 of the Contract Act and the Section 20 of the Specific Relief Act. Now, coming to the other aspects, actually, the legislature has actually ignored the common man. Not only in this statute, but in all other statutes passed recently.
Yes.
Take a case of a common man. The moment the plaintiff proves the agreement, the court is bound to grant the plaintiff a decree.
Yes.
The decision has been totally taken away. So what does it mean? A real estate mafia, somehow or other, suppose they manage to get this agreement executed, they get the property.
Correct.
The discretion of the court is taken away completely. Take the case of a loan. If it is executed as a security, even if the court is almost satisfied that it was executed as a security for a loan, that discretion is taken away.
Sir, can I just make one statement? Like, sir, if it's proved to be a sham document.
Sham is different. Sham is a different one, no doubt. It's a sham document. But it is understood that they are exploiting the situation. What the court can do? The court has no discretion at all. Suppose one is a poor man, and exploiting the poverty of the other man, he might manage to get the agreement executed. The court has no discretion at all. So actually, recently, all these legislations, see Section 138. Now, the legislature has done, if a person is unable to give money, or if he is slow in getting a compromise or compound offense, then he is punished. The moment a person, the accused, comes and says that I am innocent, he said the court is now bound to order that he should pay 20% of the check amount. So there is a trend by which the legislature ignores the common man, or they add burden to the common man. The intention is to help the real estate mafia, people like the real estate mafia. That is my view, one view. Okay.
Sir, can I just add one thing to that? Is it not recognizing or upholding the solemnity of an agreement which the law of the country says is private legislation? Unless barred by law, you are at your own volition to enter into any agreement. With open eyes, you enter into an agreement, and thereafter you say that I'm a common man, I should disown myself, or I should be relieved of the consequences. Would that be right, sir?
You are right in that sense. Okay, we have to respect the law, and a person who enters into an agreement should know the solemnity of that agreement. That is true. But at the same day, the legislature has the duty to protect the exploited also. How these ignorant people, the common man, how can they help themselves? They cannot. Only the court can help them. That helping hand also has now been taken away by the legislature. So where should they go? They have no other go. They have
Shall I put one aspect on that?
Yes.
That is, under Section 9 of the Specific Relief Act,
yes,
all the defenses available under the Contract Act are available to a person.
Correct.
Is not such a person then entitled to say that this contract was entered into by exerting coercion, fraud, undue influence? Such defenses are still available. And on the merits.
Exploitation is different from coercion.
That's true.
Exploitation is different from coercion. Suppose
or exploiting the financial situation.
Yes, whatever it be, financial or otherwise. Suppose a man knows that there will be an inordinate increase in the price.
Yes.
And the other man does not know it. And exploiting the situation.
Won't it come under mistake, common mistake? Contract Act contemplates all these situations.
It's a mutual mistake, not mistake of one man.
Correct.
Contract Act takes care of only mutual mistakes.
Correct.
Not mistake of one person. one party.
You influence, fraud, coercion, all those vitiating circumstances available under law, would that not be sufficient or should we require a legislative indulgence or a court's indulgence?
Yes, that is true. Vitiating circumstances there, the contract will go. Here the contract will not go, but the party has not been able to satisfy the conscience of the courts. That it is not a lopsided one, one-sided one. The one man was exploiting the situation, whereby the other man was not in a, was not able to assert himself. Take the case where a man has come, a boy has come of his age, just to maturity, 18 years he has completed. He enters into a contract. Ordinarily, what the court will do? The court will certainly take a favorable view to him. But now that is not possible. The entire discretion has been taken away by this legislation. So I think it is a lopsided one. It indirectly helps these people like this real estate mafia. Anyway, the second question is whether this after it is taken away, what is the effect? The discretion is taken away. And now we know that there are two types of agreements. One agreement whereby the time is fixed for performance. The other where time is not fixed. Then what is the period of limitation? When notice of refusal is there. Suppose the notice of the one demands this performance after 30 years or 25 years. What happens then? There also the court has no discretion. See, one case the Supreme Court, which reached the Supreme Court, the suit was filed after 29 years. 20 years of the agreement. Now the court refused to give him a decree. But now the court is bound to give him a decree. Because we are not concerned with the equity. It has ceased to be a court of equity now. So I think it will work out injustice. Injustice to the common man. Now coming to these amendments that is with regard to the delay. Delay, Justice Sunil Thomas mentioned that if there is a delay, the court can take it, he should come within a reasonable time. So now the legislature has given a goodbye to it. Delay, it is immaterial. You can come even on the last day of the limitation. Still, if there is a valid agreement, the court is bound to give him a decree. So that is why he mentioned that suppose a man comes after 30 years of the contract, then he is bound to, he is entitled to get a decree. Now coming to the retrospective act. Retrospective act, actually, in my view also, this appears to be a procedural one, specifically like, because the basic law is contract act. Now the amendment, actually, there are three aspects covered by the amendment. One relates to pleadings. The pleadings, it is said that the party need not, the plaintiff need not declare that he has been ready and willing to perform his part of the contract. That is the pleadings. The second is relating to evidence. He has to give evidence. He has to give evidence that he has been ready and willing to perform his part of the contract. Take a case where the plaintiff has pleaded his readiness and willingness, but the defendant did not deny it. Under the present act, the amended act, is it necessary for the plaintiff to prove it? Because the law says that he must prove, irrespective of the fact that whether it is pleadings or not. Mm-hmm. So I think that also has to be taken into consideration. So pleadings, evidence. Now the third aspect is power of the court. So the amendment relates to three aspects. One is pleadings, the other is evidence, proof. The other is the power of the court, discretion. Taken away, them. Obligatory. It is obligatory on the part of the court to give the plaintiff a decree the moment agreement is approved. Now come to these things. Retrospective means pending means it applies even to appeals. I think that is the correct view. If it is held to be retrospective, that means it is applies to a pending proceedings. That it applies to appeals also. Even if it is pending in the Supreme Court, it applies. But here, the pleadings, when was the pleadings prepared? When the amendment was not there? When the original 63 Act was in force? What about the evidence? Evidence was adduced on the basis of the provisions in the unamended 1963 Act. Then the court exercised the discretion when in the case of appeal. So I think even if it is taken to be a procedural law, it affects the rights of the parties which were settled. So when that right is taken away, can we say that it is retrospective? The party who were not aware of it, or party who did not that such a legislation would come, adduced evidence on the basis of the provisions in the law which existed then. Thereafter, can it be said that no, that is not the law, we are going to apply in a new law? I think that is injustice. So though it appears to be procedural in nature, it should be held to be substantive because of the reason that it affects the rights of the parties. So these are the three things I have to add, nothing more. Otherwise, I fully agree with Justice Sunil Thomas. Very excellent talk, especially when there is no law. Law means there is no precedent. He has covered all the aspects. As usual, he has been at his best in this battle.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
You are my teacher. You are my teacher.
Now, one more question I would like to pose. I am not giving any answer. Suppose two situations may arise. The here is a case filed after the amendment. The plaintiff need not prove readiness and willingness. So he does not plead it. But the defendant also keeps the silence. But at the same time, the amended act says that he must prove readiness and willingness. So without the pleadings, even though pleadings are not there, is he supposed to prove the readiness and willingness? That's one question. Another question is, if he does not plead it, the defendant pleads that he has not been ready and willing to perform his part of the contract. In such a case, I think there will be no problem. But in the other case, there will be some problems. So can it be said that applying these provisions in the Indian Evidence Act, a fact which is not denied, can it be treated as proved? The plaintiff pleads readiness and willingness. The defendant does not do it. And when it comes to the evidence, this section 6 says that he must prove readiness and willingness. So is he supposed to prove, notwithstanding the provision in the Evidence Act? These are the questions I would like to pose now. Yes.
Sunil sir, before we come to you, sir, three very pertinent issues has been raised by Abraham.
Correct.
One is pleadings, one is evidence,
proof,
and
proof.
The power of the court.
Yes.
Sir, because of all the statutory interdict, are we not recognizing the autonomy of the parties to enter into an agreement, as I raised earlier, was the first equation, number one.
Yes, yes.
Then, if that be so, should there be a super body, like a court, to sit in judgment whether that party had the discretion to do it or not, or whether it was right or wrong, other than implementing what has been reduced into writing?
Correct.
That to a certain extent, sir, my proposition or a submission would be that gives an unwarranted leeway to an authority which was not a privy to the contract at the time of formation. When the Contract Act gives 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 vitiating circumstances, which says that the contract could be vitiated on such and such circumstances, when the statute does not provide for such a ground, should we or can we have an additional ground given to an authority to interdict that? Number one, that's one aspect. Number two is, sir, all said and done, discretion or leeway has not been taken away would be my second submission. Because even when we say that, not in the sense like we had it earlier, but even now there is vitiating circumstances can be evaluated by the court. That would take into account all these things like whether a common man, sir has put it very beautifully, a common man enters in an agreement with another common man. So
now, Mr. Shyam, I'll tell you one aspect about the common man's issue. That's a social reality. I will tell you that whenever big projects are coming in India, in Kerala even, just before that, the politicians and the land mafia will know that such a big project is coming.
Correct.
They will start purchasing the entire area, entire properties near and near the such projects. You have heard of that?
Correct.
And people, without knowing that, they sell it. As his Lordship Justice Abraham Matthews said, it may not amount to a vitiating circumstance, but that is the social reality. Secondly, you remember that when I started the class, I said the equity principle was that discretion was the basic prime objective, or a specific performance was the rule, and damage was the rule, and specific relief was the exception. The criticism against the equity principle was that it did not honor the sanctity of contracts. Secondly, it did not honor the moral responsibility arising or moral obligation arising out of it. These concepts are not not taken into consideration when a statute is introduced. Definitely, I also say that the sanctity of the contract should be enforced. Okay. Should be honored. Question is, can you take it ex post facto? When party has pleaded all, the defendant has set up all the defenses which were available under Section 60, 14, Section 10, Section 14 and Section 16. Now all the defenses are taken away.
Sir, that presupposes...
cannot amount to a vitiating circumstance as contemplated under the Contract Act, Section 9. 9 of the Specific Relief Act, which says that all the defenses available under the Contract Act can be set up. Mistake, fraud, coercion, undue influence. That goes into the merits of the case. That is still available. But the question whether, in this case, equity principles demand an interference with the court. You remember that Nirmala's case which I referred to? If that is the present law is applied, the contract should have been performed by on payment of 60,000 rupees only on the basis of the contract which was entered into 1966, decreed in 2002. That will come. Not that we should, we are not saying that you should not agree the on of the solemnity of an agreement. But the question is, can you do it ex post facto? Pending litigation. And is it not a more advantageous benefit to the plaintiff? That's a problem.
Sir, there again, can I just put a minimal doubt?
Yes.
Earlier scenario and the present scenario. The only change is the court has been deprived of that discretionary right. Nothing else.
No. Pleading and evidence also.
Sir, also taken away. You did not plead.
Abraham Matthew, sir,
you can prove. Pleadings
and evidence was required more rigorous earlier, not now.
Hmm.
So there is no disadvantage for anybody.
Sir. No, because it's a, there may be a case wherein a person may not even plead, might not even plead, and the defendant is caught unawares when he brings in evidence. Without
so
a pleading.
The scenario. Now that's even I need only have the agreement signed, fine. That's it. Earlier, I used to say I had to plead and prove that I had been ready and willing from day one onwards. There was no delay, default, or breach on my part, etc. Now that's not necessary. So I think now the pleading may not stand in the way. I don't know, sir. I leave to your better.
Correct. Question is whether it should have a retrospective operation or not.
That's where I mean. That exactly is the point.
That is where the point. That's where the shoe pinches.
Correct. Absolutely correct.
So anybody else has got a different view on that?
Yeah, that of course, sir. I mean, that's what the beauty of law is all about. Different views, sir. Sir, we have Jayaprasad MR with a question. Jayaprasad, please.
Please.
Jayaprasad, are you there? Please unmute and put your question. Manoj?
Somebody has now raised a question whether can we not analyze individual statutory provision and decide the retrospective? It will not be possible.
Okay, please mute. Okay, sir, sorry, we were on you. I mean, yes.
Anybody?
Sir, please.
Hello?
Yes. Yeah, Manoj, please.
Hello, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, my doubt is, as per Section 20 of SR Act, whenever the other party has breaches or not willing to perform the contract, other party can substitute the performance by the third party or his own agency.
Yes.
But as per Section 20 of TP Act, covenant agreement binds only to the party but not the third party. Yeah. What is the remedy, sir?
Now, there is a difference. No, I will not say that there is a difference. Transfer of Property Act deals with the contract between the parties. Now, when that is interdicted by or superseded by a statutory provision, there should not be any difficulty into getting it done. Because that is a statutory protection available to a person. So that will not, be any incongruity in that. Yes.
Jayaprasad?
Yes, Mr. Jayaprasad?
Can you unmute yourself, please? You put your hands up. Fine. Okay. There's some problem with this. We have Annika Raman. Please, Annika, please put your question.
Hello.
Yeah.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, the question that I wanted to, I think Sunil Thomas sir already answered that it may not be possible. But just to explain my question, sir. Usually when a section is amended, we also look at, for example, in the case of Section 16, the precedents that you cited seem to also indicate, sir, that the amendment may can be seen to be perhaps only clarificatory in nature. So in that case, there has not been much change in the position regarding pleadings. But even if we were to assume, sir, I'll just complete my question. But if we go forward and think of it that the section has been amended, can we not see that, sir, Section 16 may affect the substantive right, and therefore it can be obviously it can be applied only for prospective cases. But once you test the law on the benchmark of the erstwhile provision, and under Section 20, it earlier said merely because it was legal to grant specific performance, it need not be granted.
Need not be granted.
But now, when you juxtapose it with the present amended Section 20, once it is legal to grant specific performance, then because of the amended provision, it is now mandatory. So Section 16 would be the earlier provision, and you test whether it is legal to grant specific performance on the basis of the old law. But because if you then see that Section 20 is only a remedy or a procedural law, then you can say that part of it becomes retrospective, and therefore the grant by the court is now mandatory. I'm sorry if this is it's a little bit of too much of...
No, not at all. I'll answer you, Anagap.
Thank you, sir.
To decide whether a given statute is retrospective or not, we apply various parameters. We apply various tests. One test is ascertain whether it is a substantive or procedural one. Secondly, it takes away substantive rights conferred on a person. Maybe the statute may be procedural as such, but there it may have certain statutes which there are certain provisions which confer rights on parties. Say, for example, CPC, though we say that it is a procedural nature, there are provisions which confer right of appeal. So when we decide whether a given statute will operate retrospectively or not, these are the parameters that we apply. And another parameter is, take the individual statutes and how far it affects the existing provision, existing rights, existing system. And that is to, we analyze that to ascertain whether the statute as a whole is retrospective or not. Because there cannot be a statute which in certain sections are retrospective, certain sections are prospective.
The only reason that I thought of this was, had the Amendment Act completely replaced the old 1963 Act as it did in when the 1963 Act came into being,
yes,
then we have no recourse but to see the new Act in toto. It cannot be split and seen. But now, since this is only an amendment of specific provisions of the old Act, can we not? That is why I thought, can we not view independent sections, amendment to independent sections individually to test whether it is prospective or retrospective?
No, I'll tell you the difference. When the 1963 Act repealed the earlier statute and a new statute was brought in, the basic concept of it being a discretionary remedy and the defendants were carried forward. So the situation that has arisen now was not there. The 1963 Act also made the statute right of the court discretionary, duty of the court discretionary, power of the court discretionary. That did not affect as such. So probably in that background, the Calcutta High Court went to considered that it is a retrospective in operation. But at the same time, that was not taken up for consideration. The Supreme Court did not get an opportunity to consider the legality of that. But still, that is a precedent. So that makes the difference.
Right. Thank you, sir.
Yes.
I have one question.
Yes.
Shyam.
Anybody else?
Shyam, I'm here, sir. I have a question, yes, sir.
Ah.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, suppose under a development agreement,
yeah,
in which the builder, owner and the builders have a 50-50 share. Suppose 10 floors are sought to be constructed. Proposal is for 10 floors. Assuming that the builder abandons the project after completing 5 floors, then if Section 20 comes into play, that is a substituted contract comes into operation, yes, and they enter into a separate contract and the next builder completes the project. The question, yes, is, because the contract that is was there between the earlier builder who has 50% share. So in the 5 floors that he has constructed, his shares will still be there. If 20 is brought into existence, who will get that share? What would be, can it be said that he loses his share totally? Because if that share was to be shared by it goes to the earlier builder, then who gets that builder? Will the owner get it or subsequent contractor gets it? Because it's
I'll tell you. The thing is that substituted performance is only for the limited purpose of getting the contract executed.
Executed.
That will not override, that will not create a new rights on the parties.
True.
So the scope of the statute is only to get the contract work executed, which it fails. So that the right which was to go to the original builder cannot go to the person who does it. He's only entitled for his remuneration.
Remuneration.
Otherwise, you are introducing a new party to the contract.
True.
That cannot happen. And if you go through the wording of Section 20, you'll find that it can be got executed, but performed. And that new rights cannot be created by virtue of that execution.
So, in my understanding, then, in such a situation, the issue that the share of the original builder is remains a dispute then. Remains unresolved. It remains correct, a dispute correct, between correct. Them. This 20 does not solve that problem.
No.
It's only for execution.
Correct. Now that can be worked out.
Separately worked out.
Yes. Question of expenses, cost and compensation arises.
Sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
We have Nazir Boydu with a question. Nazir, can you just put the question?
Yes. Anybody else?
Hello, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, Nazir.
Yes. My question is, do the terms of contract having a provision about the third party provision in the contract before 2018 contract takes away the amendment with regard to the procedural law?
Yes.
If it is concluded as procedural law.
Now, after the Registration and Related Amendment Act of 2001, is not the agreement for sale, agreement to be registered?
That is 2017.
Yes. No, 2001. That is the Registration and Related Statutes Amendment Act, which amended the Registration Act, the Stamp Act, and the Transfer of Property Act, which which amended Section 53A also of the Transfer of Property Act.
No, I'm not.
It was in the year 2001.
Without interruption, then not about the agreement for sale. It is a contract. It is a contract for any building contract.
Correct.
Yes. There is
now,
a provision.
Now, registration, the question whether it requires registration or not, there is no harm in executing an oral agreement.
Yes.
There is no harm in registering in executing an unregistered agreement.
Yes.
Provided the statute does not insist for that. If there is no legal bar, there is no question of this arising, this dispute arising.
See, that's it all. Can be. Yeah.
Yes. It can be. Yes.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Nazir. Manoj, do you have a question? You unmuted yourself.
No, sir, I have completed the year.
Wonderful. Okay.
Hello.
If no more questions, shall we wind up, Mr. Shah?
We'll just conclude, sir. Prem, over to you.
Yeah, sir. I do have a small doubt. First of all, it was a great lecture and we all got a lot of learning. I do have a very small doubt. Now, the amending act, it makes certain contracts which earlier was not enforceable, right? Like what you say is even a breach of which could be compensated in money, terms of money. Now, it's being capable of enforced. So, that be so, isn't it that amending act really substantive? Because what came up for consideration was the specifically fact of 1963, which the High Courts went on to say that it was, of course, it was procedural. But now, see the amendments. See, the amendments, there are certain contracts which earlier were not enforceable and not capable of being enforced. And right now, doesn't the Amending Act to a clear extent, isn't it clearly substantive? Because it provides for a new remedy itself. And just see, why I'm telling you is that, so Contract Act, see Section 28 of the Contract Act.
Yes.
Section 28 of the Contract Act is Lord Chief Justice Nariman had the occasion that IndusInd Bank case of 2016. Yes. 9 SEC 720. His Lordship went on to say it is substantive and remedial. But of course, His Lordship went on to say that it is not declaratory or clarificatory.
Yes.
So the contract that governs this particular specific relief act as well. Right, sir, because everything is based on that contract. Everything is based upon the contract act which we have built up in the specific relief act also. So, when Section 28 itself was found by the Supreme Court to be a substantive one, then don't you feel, sir, that the amending act, it is substantive? And especially keeping in view that there is no ripple clause, no saving, nothing.
Now, that exactly was the point raised by Justice Abraham Mathew. Because he said the substantive law is the Contract Act.
Correct.
And secondly, the Calcutta decision which referred to the 1963 Act said went on the parameter of being a procedural one. Correct. Not only that, in a different context in 1977, which I referred to, the Supreme Court also said, the Speaker by Alice held that it is a procedural law, but that was not on the question whether the right on this issue. That's why I also agree with you that to a certain extent it affects the substantive rights of the parties, and to that extent cannot be retrospective.
Right. And sir, don't you feel?
I agree with you. What you said.
And sir, with regard to Section 20A, and we have another new Section 20B, which would constitute the special course, right?
Yes.
So 20A, and we have a new schedule also with regard to what are all the infrastructure things which should under the particular statute. Don't you think that it would be a conflict? Why? Because we have the Commercial Courts Act of 2015. We have where the commercial dispute that also involves certain like the what you say the. Infrastructure disputes which are dealt with in the specific relief act, the Amendment Act of 2018, would they go together? Because both platforms, the special court which is constituted under that act of 2015 and a special court which is constituted under Section 20B of this particular amendment. So, both platforms are interested in the responsibility of adjudicating similar cases. What is your take on that, sir?
Now, this is not the only statute that has created such a issue situations. There are other statutes also which create overlapping jurisdiction on courts.
Exactly.
That has happened. Say, for example, Money Laundering Act.
Correct.
Coupled with other criminal cases.
Correct.
It has been dealt with by the special court under the Money Laundering Act. So that situation may come. But at the same time, what you have to understand is that how far it affects creation of a new forum cannot affect the parties, because that is not going to affect the substantive right of a person.
Right.
Whether this court or that other court does it is immaterial.
But sir, I'm just asking, because creation of a new forum or rather a special court by a special court, by a separate notification, because what I said is the special court has to be notified as a special court, right? Yes. By a separate notification.
The court can be designated and notified as a probably so, an existing court can even be notified.
Existing court also, of course. So just like when you try the PC Act, because PC Act takes a special court by its own. All the other courts are precluded. So normally would a clash occur between, the special courts under this 2015 Commercial Courts Act as well as the 2018 amended specific relief act. Are both the platforms, both the special courts can now go on dealing with all the matters. Is it like that? Both the courts are free to do? Or is it that only one court can?
Yes. Now,
regarding the infrastructure only, I'm asking. Regarding the infrastructure only.
That also there will not be any problem at all. Because the law that is applicable remains the same. The substantive law and the procedural law that applies in both cases remains the same. So whether it has been transferred from one court to another court does not make any difference.
No, and sir. I'm not asking. I'm not asking the question of transfer, sir. Because here we have the substantive law is the Indian Contract Act, which is going to get applied. Now, even regarding the Commercial Courts Act also, commercial dispute means basically they have to deal with the Contract Act. Now, to deal with this type of provisions, a special court has been established under the Specific Relief Act to deal with the infrastructure disputes. Same thing is there 3 years before in the Commercial Courts Act. yes. which also contains a special code. So same jurisdiction is given to both special codes. With, so do you mean to say that both those courts would be having like a sort of concurrent jurisdiction?
Concurrent jurisdiction. Issue. Correct.
Is it like that? Okay, sir. So that was my. That's true.
That may create some problem.
Thank you very much, sir. It was a very great class. Fantastic.
Thank you.
Abhinav Mehta, sir, if you can add something to that, we can close the session because we have come to the end of the session. Sir, you need to unmute yourself. Abhinav Mehta, sir, you need to unmute. Yeah, okay.
No, I don't want to add anything to it. In fact, the Supreme Court has considered when a procedural law has been or can be considered to be substantive, etc., these are all matters to be looked into later. But as of now, I think it affects the rights of the parties. Whether it is in the form of evidence or pleadings or judgment of the court, it affects the rights of the parties. And when it affects the rights of the parties, though it is a procedural in form, in substance, it is a substantive right. That appears to be a reasonable view. But as Justice Sunil Thomas said, let there be a pronouncement by a competent forum, by the High Court or the Supreme Court. Right. We can wait for it.
Absolutely right, sir. So
okay, that's true.
But what I would like to add is this. The recent legislations, they ignore the common man. They ignore the poor people. See this negotiation act. The moment an accused pleads that he is not guilty, what does the court order? The court has to order that he should pay 20% of the check amount. And what about the fundamental principle of presumption of innocence? Before he is found guilty, he is ordered to pay a certain amount, which can be paid only by way of punishment or compensation. So this is actually what happens in our nation and country now. Yes.
At the risk of being branded as somebody who's anti-common man, I would only suggest or say, sir, that once you enter into an agreement or a contract or a negotiable instrument, it should have some basic value. Otherwise, you have all the defenses under the sun and, sir, that's my perception. Absolutely. I may be wrong also.
Fully agree with that view. But at the same time, we have to protect these ignorant people also. It is a court of law and justice, and not only a court of law. Now it has been reduced to a court of law.
The legislature. There should be a legislation which says that if you are ignorant, if you are not 10th standard plus, your agreements will be treated in another category. If you are 10th standard plus, another category. Till then, can we make an interdict, sir?
Yes, I think that they must be there. The judiciary must be given that power. Because the oppressed and the suppressed, where do they go? They cannot go anywhere else.
Not even for a second, I should be mistaken for something. I just aired a view that is possible. I fully subscribe with whatever you said, sir. I mean, there is absolutely no parallel regarding that.
Our courts have been reduced to courts of law instead of courts of law and justice. There is no justice, only law. Yes.
Justice.
So, sir, all the statutes are now ad hoc arrangements.
Absolutely.
Just to meet the present situation, some statute is brought in.
Without looking into the broad spectrum.
Simply
we are borrowing ideas and the laws from other countries.
Yes.
Without realizing that they are not applicable to our nation.
Correct, sir. But end of the day, we vote for these characters. They become the legislators. They bring out the law. And the court is not supposed to legislate also. So... sir, we'll leave it as that. But the wonderful thing about today's session, like all our sessions are, is that we have brought up certain questions, certain things which require more contemplation, deliberation.
Correct.
We'll definitely do. And that, in fact, is the very purpose and intent of this continuing legal education. So, sir, this brings us to the end of the 44th session of lectures, that is Empowerment Through Interaction Lecture Series. We are deeply indebted to Justice Sunil Thomas, sir, for sharing his views taking us through the nuances of specific relief act, specific performance of contract, and especially the 2018, and leaving more thankful because more questions have been left open than answered.
Correct. Thank you, Shyam. Thank you, all the participants.
May I just this opportunity.
Yeah.
Can I just pose a question?
Yeah. Oh, Vijay, please. Go ahead.
See, I was going through this Section 10, this amendment. It says that court shall grant specific performance. Why? I just had a wonder. I was just wondering, can there be a legislation mandating a court to do what to do, what not to do? Because the end of the day, discretion is should be left to the court. Court shall do would be to tantamount into interference with their adjudicatory process.
Yes. But that's not an absolute power. It is subject to 11, 2, 14 and 16.
True, sir. But that is only subjective to only such conditions. But what
that's
is
true.
Found, finds, because courts are supposed to be common courts.
And then secondly, one more thing. It does not affect Section 9. All the grounds on which a contract can be challenged can is available.
I was only looking at the equity part. Equity part.
That's what we are worried about.
Equity is left to the wind down. Because specific performance with regard to immovable property would take substantial time in trial court as well as in high court. Because by the time a generation passes. So by the end of the second generation, if you were to say that you execute the contract which your previous generation has executed, that would be totally inequitable. That is what, because as you know, as your lordship is aware, it takes at least 20 years for the High Court to hear an appeal, in at least in Hyderabad. So to say that an agreement which is executed sometime in 90s or 80s should be specifically enforced through a decree.
In the same terms.
In the same terms would be highly inequitable. If the equity is not there, I was only wondering if it is going to interdict the discretion of the court. Because there can't be a legislature in mandating the court to do what to do, what not to do. In its discretion. That's what I had.
The hands of the courts are now tied.
Absolutely, absolutely. You cannot say anything against the legislative wisdom. Coming out with the legislation. The courts are only supposed to interpret it, and if it does fall within the four corners of the intra vias principle, I'm not very sure that we have.
What he asked is a very relevant question. See, almost like this, many of us may remember Amarunisa Begum's case of 1953. That was a similar statute that came from Hyderabad only. The fourth section contained that we called upon the court to do this. Actually, it was a suit for partition regarding the properties of Nizam. And finally, that particular section got quashed when it reached the Supreme Court.
Correct. Only if it does not withstand the test of constitutionality. Otherwise, you will have to implement the statute. That's my take on that. I'll leave it.
Correct. Which includes the reasonableness also.
Correct.
As they can always read shall as may, as they do it in many of the statutes.
Maybe this is a transition stage wherein there will be casualties. But maybe the sanctity of agreements and contracts will be much more once everybody realizes that you just cannot enter into agreements without understanding it. Maybe. I don't know. Abraham Matthew sir will not agree with me. I'm 100% sure. So, that brings us to the end of the 44th session of Legal Empowerment Through Interaction lecture series. It was, in fact, I'd say that all of you made it much so beautiful and interactive, and especially thanks to Sunil sir, Abraham Matthew sir, and in the initial stages, we had both Chidambare sir as well as Ram Kumar sir. All of you, thank you very much. The journey continues. Tomorrow, 3:30, we have Justice Gopinath with Should Public Law Remedies Be Discretionary? 3:30 tomorrow, we'll find out. Till then, take care. Stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.